The following presentation is brought to you by American Legion Pulse 416, Greendale, Wisconsin. Veterans of Foreign Wars, VFW Post 10, 519, Greendale, Wisconsin. Disabled American Veterans, DAV Chapter 19, West Allis, Wisconsin. The Veterans Community Relations Team, VCRT, Milwaukee, Wisconsin. Machinery and Welder Corporation, West Allis, Wisconsin. And by viewers like you. From the global resources of Veterans Media Services. This is Veterans Newsline with Dave Ryback. Military working dogs have been used by the U.S. military since World War I. The dogs originally enlisted by the Quartermaster Corps, and a diversity of breeds were accepted. Once knowledge and experience were gained, the dogs of choice became the German Shepherd and the Doberman Pinscher. Due to the nature of the work to be accomplished, the Labrador eventually replaced the Doberman. The German Shepherd remained the most frequently used dog. These dogs are commonly referred to as war dogs, however, the correct term is military working dogs. They have saved countless lives and casualties since the beginning of their military service, and they continue to do so today. Today, we are in Menominee Falls, Wisconsin for the memorial dedication of the War Dogs Monument. In a minute, we'll be talking to Jerry Witt, a member of the War Dogs group, about today's event. But first, let's take a few minutes to talk to some of the folks who attended today's event. All right, now joining me is Carol Singer at the War Dogs event here in Menominee Falls. And Carol, that's a wonderful looking animal you have there. Can you tell us a little bit about it?
She's a Doberman Pinscher, and she's 9 years old, and she's also a therapy dog, and we go to the Veterans Hospital and visit the vets in the spinal care section, and she represents the Doberman breed that was in World War II.
World War II for the Doberman breed.
Yes.
And today this dog serves our veterans by going to hospitals and events and things like that. Well, thank you, Carol, very much for talking with us a little bit today.
All right, and with me now is David Poley, also with the War Dogs group here at the War Dogs event today. And David, can you tell us a little bit about these fine animals you have here?
Yes, these are Siberian Huskies. They were used as sled dogs in the Northern Arctic regions to get men and supplies to the weather stations in Greenland and the Baffin Islands.
Wow, that's pretty interesting. And what are you doing? Do these dogs continue to serve our veterans today? Visit them at hospitals or anything like that?
Just at our presentations for the War Dogs group and in the parades.
All right. Well, I want to thank you, David, very much for taking a few minutes to talk with us today.
Thank you.
And joining me now is Carol Summers.
Carolyn
Summers, and she's also here with the War Dogs group today. And Carolyn, why don't you tell us about this little fella you have in your helmet here?
Okay, well, we represent Smokey from World War II. She was found in Guinea, and they used her to pull communication lines through the culverts under the airfield so they didn't have to rip up the airfields. So they credit her with saving a lot of lives. because they didn't have to shut down the airfields.
So dogs this small were used as combat dogs or in the military, huh?
Well, at least this one, we represent Smokey. I don't know how many other ones there were in the U.S. There were some in the British armies, but also they credit her for being the first therapy dog. Because he trained her with a lot of tricks and took her to hospital and to entertain the troops and all. And actually, I've been in contact with the handler. He still lives in Ohio, 92 years old. So it's been a wonderful, he told us a lot more about Smokey. So that's who we represent.
All right. Well, I want to thank you very much to take the time to talk with us today.
Well, thank you.
All right. Good afternoon. And joining me now is Jerry Witt. Is that right? Jerry Witt, and he's with the War Dogs Group. And Jerry, tell us, first of all, a little bit about the War Dogs and the role in history these canine friends of ours played in military efforts throughout history.
Well, our group called War Dogs was started in 1999. And what our mission was to educate the public on how the various breeds of dogs have been used in the military in the wars that our country has fought, because they have been invaluable and saved a lot of lives. I am a former dog handler. I was a dog handler in Vietnam, and we had a five-year project that we wanted to erect a monument in honor of these four-legged soldiers. And today is a culmination of all of our efforts so that we can have this done. And we're very proud and happy to say that, you know, it's time that they get their due recognition.
Okay, and tell us a little bit about the event that we're about to see today here in Menominee Falls today.
Well, today we're going to have various Vietnam vets that I was actually in Vietnam with that came in. I have three of my former buddies from Vietnam here, and we have a lot of other groups with like canine units and so forth, veterans, etc., that are here to help dedicate this monument. So we're very proud and happy to say that we're having it looks like a really good turnout, and the weather was with us, so we're very honored to be able to do this.
All right, and thank you very much for taking the time to talk with us today.
You are welcome. Thank you so much.
Good afternoon, and thank you for attending the dedication of the first War Dog Memorial in Wisconsin. My name is Kim Michalowski, and I was an Air Force canine handler in Vietnam from 1971 to 1972. And I can state without a doubt that I'm standing here today because of the faithful service and sacrifice of two wonderful German Shepherds, Hobo, M793, and Prince, S794. At this time, I'd like to ask you to please stand for the presentation of the colors by American Legion Post 449 and the singing of our national anthem by Menominee Falls Chief of Police, Anna Wyszynski.
Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, o'er the ramparts we watched, were so gallantly streaming, and the rockets' red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say does that star-spangled banner yet wave o'er the land of the free and the home of the brave?
Please remain standing as I bring up Chaplain Ray Stubbe for the invocation. Chaplain.
What a beautiful day the good Lord has given to us, and especially being with all our friends and our four-legged friends too. Let us pray. O Lord our God, creator of all life, we thank you for the gift of war dogs. Through them, O Lord, you bless us with companionship, protection, and guidance in dark times and dangerous places. Through them, O Lord, we know your presence with us in all places. Through their faithfulness and watchfulness as companions on our way, and by their ability to detect explosives in the presence of the enemy, you, O Lord, have saved thousands of lives. Accept, O Lord, our gratitude and keep us always in the protective peace and presence of your holy name, we pray. Amen.
I would now like to present Vietnam veteran Joe Campbell, who presents the Missing and Fallen Comrades tribute.
Thank you, Kim. I have to start out when he said that we must start right now, that we do that in the Army. In the Army, it was always hurry up and wait, Kim. And wait we did. I'm here to share and explain why we have this table set up in front of us. And you notice it's set for one. And I think the significance is I'll explain in a minute what it's all about. But I'd be remiss if I didn't talk about World War I. We lost 116,516. And to this date, there's still 3,350 missing. World War II. And if we ever want to understand our freedom, 405,399 paid the ultimate sacrifice. And we just celebrated D-Day on June 6th. And many of you know we lost over 20,000 men that first day. And from that war, there are still 30,333 missing. Korea, even though it was only 2 years, we lost over 33,741. We also lost over 20,000 due to the frozen chosen. And to this day, there's still 5,127 that are missing. Vietnam, 58,272 paid the ultimate sacrifice. There are still 2,489 that are missing. In our Cold Wars, and that's from 1945 to 1955. A lot of people don't realize 92 paid the ultimate sacrifice, and thank God there are none missing. In Panama, we lost 40, and thank God none are missing. In Grenada, we lost 19. And again, thank God, none are missing. In the Gulf War, 382 were killed in action. Thank God again, none are missing. In Iraq, and I don't know how I could ever overlook saying Iraq, especially to a crowd like this, where 4,489 paid the ultimate sacrifice. And with the chaos going on in that country right now, I don't know how they can deal with it. But I do know that we Vietnam veterans will do all we can to make sure that they have the help, support, and will never, ever be treated the way we were when we came back. And to my dear brothers and sisters that are presently serving in Afghanistan, somewhat in doubt, but still serving their country, primarily fighting for each other. We have lost over 2,331 to date. And again, I say to my Iraqi and Afghanistan vets, we are not just behind you, we are with you, and we're gonna do, I'm sure you join me in making sure that we will make sure that not only they are welcomed home, but we will help them go through that struggle that they have to listen to night after night on the news. How many World War II vets do we have here? Just, you don't have to stand, just put your arms up. You know, I know why they call you the greatest generation. I thought it was ours. Of course, I always said we were the Burger King generation because we wanted to have it our way. But you allowed us to have it our way. You allowed this day to be possible. And despite the conflicts that are going on in this world of ours, we have the freedom to gather, to pray, to support, to love and care for one another because of what you and your families did for us. And I can't thank you enough. And I know we have some Korean War veterans with us. And now most of you can stand, some can't. Korea War. Sometimes referred to as the Forgotten War. But I can assure you, it's not forgotten by us. And the freedom that you allowed that country to at least have half of it in freedom and support of our government and our people, we truly appreciate it. Thank you. Now to my Vietnam vet brothers, and I know there are a lot here. And if you can stand up, I really would like you to. Isn't that a great sound? I don't think we heard that when we came back. Welcome home. Welcome home. God, what they said to us when we came home, I can't believe it. But never again will one generation abandon another. And the Vietnam vets have really stepped up to the plate, as I shared earlier, to make sure that none of our brothers and sisters or their families are going to suffer the way we did. Because as we learn to heal, that will help others. And I am so grateful to be a Vietnam vet and knowing we fought our asses off to win that damn war. And as far as I'm concerned, we did. Yeah. Iraqi vets, please stand up. I've already shared, but Dan, please stay standing. The gentleman there in the red shirt headed up the Fisher House of Wisconsin. And we broke ground on June 3rd for a Fisher House. And this gentleman right here, an Iraqi wounded war veteran, led that cause. And we were the first of all the Fisher Houses to achieve the financial goal to get it started. Thank you, Dan, and your wonderful team. And our Afghanistan vets, I know there's a couple here. Please stand up, let me see where you're at. Where are they at? They just put their hand up. We are with you. We are with you. And we pray that our government will get this job done right. Now I'd like to explain this table. I just gave you the reason for it. And it's set for one, which we all know is one too many. We got a beautiful plate. We got a butter plate with a little salt, a little lemon. We have a candle, and we have a glass that's inverted because they are not here. And we will not forget them. And Jerry, I can't thank you enough for allowing and this to be presented as we try to do at any ceremony so we can truly honor and never forget and do all we can to account for each and every one of our brothers and sisters that are missing. But there's one thing missing from this table. And now I would like to call upon three special people, led by my brother, Vietnam veteran, Peter Tights. Peter's brother, James Neal Tights, was killed in action on May 10th, 1967. His remains were not found until February of 2005. And be it only three teeth, they did find, and he was finally laid to rest on May 10th, 2005, 38 years after he was killed. And Peter is followed by my very, very close friends from Menominee Falls. Bob and Irene Cornell, whose son paid the ultimate price. On November 9th, 2004, at the age of 38. And they placed that Bible on this table. Because we are one nation, we are under God, and we do know that faith is the key to survival. And I want to thank you so much. The only thing I can say is thank you very much. It means so much to have our four pawed soldiers who saved so many lives. And I can assure you, the dogs I recall in Vietnam were always out front. Always out front. And I don't think I'd be here today if it wasn't for the dogs and those men that definitely trained and worked with them to do all they could to keep us here and bring us back alive. And now, I would like to recognize our dog handlers and also our dog handlers that were killed in action in Vietnam from our state. And I'd like to call upon Terrence Beck. Terrence, Eugene Slasky. Can you come to the table, Eugene? Eugene, United States Marine Corps World War veteran in the South Pacific, and he will be supported with Terrence Beck, a United States Marine Corps scout handler from Fort Atkins, Wisconsin, who was killed on December 10th, 1967. Kevin McCarthy. Kevin. United States Army helicopter door gunner. Representing Joseph Terafinski from the 557th Combat Tracker, Oneida. He was killed in action on February 6, 1971. Kim. Kim was a United States Air Force sentry dog handler in Vietnam, and he is honoring the memory of Clayton Jenkins, a United States military sentry dog from Pembine, Wisconsin, who was killed on June 3rd, 1969. Grant, Gary Grant. Gary was with the United States dog handler, 34th Infantry Platoon Scout Dog in Vietnam. And he is here in memory of Wilhelm Hertzman from the 43rd Infantry Platoon Scout Dog, Rhinelander, Wisconsin, who was killed on December 22nd, 1968. Joe Mays. Joe served in the United States Army Scout Dog Handler, 34th Infantry Platoon Scout Dog, Vietnam. And is he in here for the memory of Leo Mayer, 61st Combat Tracker from Fond du Lac, Wisconsin, who was killed on October 5th, 1968. Bob France. Bob was a U.S. Army Scout Dog Handler, again from the 34th Infantry Platoon Scout Dog, Vietnam, and he is here in memory of Terry Payne, a United States Scout Dog Handler from La Crosse, Wisconsin, who was killed August 5th, 1970. Jerry Witt, a United States dog handler, again from the 34th Infantry Platoon Scout Dog, Vietnam, representing Richard Benesetsky, United States Scout Dog Handler, again from the 34th Infantry Platoon Scout Dog, who was killed from Pulaski, October 25th, 1968. And now I would like Kevin Witt, United States Navy veteran. Kevin is representing all the dog handlers, all the dogs that were killed in action in the wars of our country, has fought both past, present, and all veterans who gave their lives for the freedom that we enjoy today. May God bless you all and rest in peace. Our brothers. Amen. Thank you.
I'm going to give you a little bit of history, and then we're going to have some guest speakers. History of dogs assisting humans defending home and livestock dates back to possibly 6,000 BC. Training techniques and breeds used in modern military police work developed in Western Europe and England during the latter half of the 1800s. By World War I, Germany had 30,000 trained dogs available for military service. U.S. troops admired and borrowed dogs used by the English and French, but the U.S. military had little to no interest in forming a canine corps, as the general belief was that there would be no U.S. involvement in any future wars. I have to smile at that. Western Europe was well prepared for World War II. Germany fielded 100,000 dogs. The U.S. military finally acknowledged the need for military canines after the attack on Pearl Harbor. Dogs for Defense was formed to recruit dogs from U.S. citizens to become military dogs. Many different breeds and crossbreeds were accepted. Dogs were trained and served as sentries, scout dogs, mine detectors, and messengers. Most were returned to civilian life after the war. During the Vietnam War, the U.S. military was breeding and training its own dogs. These dogs saved countless lives by alerting to personnel in enemy-held territory, in defense, in dense jungle to avoid ambush. They also alerted to various booby traps and tripwires. Booby traps, by the way, now are called improvised explosive devices. The Army always comes up with fancy names for those kinds of things. These dogs were considered military equipment. As U.S. troops withdrew, they were ordered to leave their canine comrades behind. One of the hardest days of my life was leaving my dog Prince in Vietnam. It is believed that most of our all perished from starvation or being used as food by the local population. During his tenure, President Clinton signed a bill which would enable soldiers to apply to have U.S. military dogs to be discharged back to civilian life. Currently, the U.S. military uses Jack Russells, Belgian Malinois, Labradors, Pitbull Terriers, Springer Spaniels, and German Shepherds in various duties, both home and abroad. I'm going to introduce our first speaker, is Vietnam veteran David Pohl, and he's going to tell you a little bit more about the breeds and how the military has used those dogs. Thank you, David.
Good afternoon. There are many different dog breeds, but the following are the breeds that were trained for use by the military. German Shepherds. They were used as sentry duty and scout dogs for duty in early detection of personnel, booby traps, weapons, caches, cadaver duty, house searches, and explosive detection. On duty from World War II to the present day. Belgian Malinois. When the Navy SEALs landed in Pakistan to capture and kill Osama bin Laden, one member of the raiding party was a Belgian Malinois, a dog trained for the military. Doberman Pinscher, used for sentry duty and scout dog duty in World War II and Korea. They were the official dog of the Marine Corps in World War II. Labrador Retriever, tracker dogs used for tracking blood trails and to help rescue downed pilots and wounded soldiers, used in Vietnam, Iraq, and Afghanistan. The Airedale, used in World War I and World War II as messenger dogs. The Collie, used in the military as carriers of medical supplies for wounded soldiers in the field. The Red Cross also used them in the same manner, even today. Huskies, used in World War II in the Arctic regions as sled dogs to help transport men and equipment. Boxers, used in World War II for guard dog duty and intimidation during interrogations. The Beagle. They were often used as drug and bomb sniffing dogs by the military and at airports around the world. Newfoundland, used for water rescue by the Navy and Marines. Poodle Shortcut, used for sentry duty and messenger duty in the South Pacific and Europe during World War II. Giant Schnauzer, used in World War I and World War II for guard dog duties. Also used for explosive detection and tracking of wounded soldiers. Pit Bull Terrier, used currently in Iraq, Afghanistan for bomb detection. Springer Spaniel, used today in Iraq and Afghanistan for bomb detection and cadaver duty. Jack Russell Terrier, used in Iraq and Afghanistan for bomb detection. And last, the Yorkshire Terrier, used in World War II to pull communication wires through trenches and foxholes.
Our next speaker is Mr. I gotta find my other notes, hold on a second. Right, I know that, but I got something else that you wanted me to read. I don't know what happened to it. You may have. All right, it's Mr. Jose Hernandez. He's a former canine handler with the Milwaukee County Sheriff's Department and is currently employed with the House of Corrections. Mr. Hernandez.
A beautiful afternoon. I have the rainy speech and the fair weather speech, and when I showed Jerry my good weather speech, he said no way. So I'm going to give you the rainy speech. It's a little shorter. The unveiling of the War Dogs Monument today is certainly a result of years of dedication and determination by those that recognize the unconditional service of our canine partners. We're all familiar with the vast array of services that the dogs can be trained in: leading the blind, detecting seizures, law enforcement, locating missing persons, just to name a few. These are all noble deeds and provide a great benefit. But in my opinion, none can compare to the service of a military working dog. The War Dogs group has educated many people, including myself, on the various breeds and tasks performed by these military working dogs. With such an impressive history, it seems long overdue that we pay homage to the services of these animals. The military working dog assists in providing safe passage for many soldiers through hostile and dangerous situations, all at the bidding of their handlers. Placing his life in danger to keep the soldiers out of harm's way. All of this to me equates to the protection of our freedoms we enjoy here in the United States. In doing so, it is important to also recognize the roles that these dogs have played in protecting these freedoms. I thank you to all of you and your military service, and I thank all of you in the War Dogs group that have made this monument possible. I encourage all of you to continue to tell the heroic tales of military service that your canines have performed, and may their memories live on through this monument for all to see. Thank you.
I am now honored to present our next speaker, Matt Elliott. Matt is an Iraq veteran, he's kennel master and handler, and is part of the U.S. Ambassador's High Threat Protection Team.
I want to thank Jerry for inviting me for this momentous occasion, which is long in the making from what I hear. I'm Matt Elliott, Chief of Special Operations. We're a division of the Security Arts Corporation. This is Canine Ice. He's multi-patrol protection explosives. 2009, I was recruited by the Department of Defense to train the guard force in Baghdad, Iraq, which was being guarded by 173 Ugandans. At that time, they had 8 canines. I'm a kennel master trainer for multi-patrol protection narcotics, multi-patrol protection explosives, and a certified kennel master. So I took on that task. The dogs, the canines, whatever breeds we had in Malinois, the shepherds, were outstanding. They guarded the ECPs, they took care of the checkpoints, they made sure none of the IEDs made it inside the base or the FOB. 2010, I was recruited to go to Afghanistan and train the guard force there, which consisted of Americans, Bosnians, and white South Africans. And we had an 8-person canine team there that consisted of multi-patrol protection explosives, multi-patrol protection narcotics detection dogs. Again, we were taking care of the base, take care of ECPs, taking care of all the checkpoints, and making sure no improvised explosives made it in the base. One of the side notes of that, I was contacted a couple times by the Afghan general who ran Cab Hero. And he wanted me to run the canines through the quarters for the Afghan soldiers. I says, well, which canines would you like me to run? The narcotics canines or the explosive canines? He said, oh, no narcotics, just explosive dog. Okay, I understood what that meant. So we would form up at a checkpoint, and when missions were completed, we would make sure that the Afghan soldiers that were coming back in from Afghanistan or in the area were not carrying any improvised explosives, and you all know the stories you've read about that on the news. While I was in Afghanistan, I was recruited by the State Department to serve on the Ambassador's High Threat Protection Team as a canine handler for explosives and a kennel master. I went over in 2011 to serve in Baghdad, Iraq, on the Ambassador's High Threat Protection Team. We ran 86 missions. I was on the Ambassador's Protection Detail as well as the Iraqi Protection Detail whenever they wanted to leave the embassy to go meet at the Ministry of Oil, Ministry of Finance, whatever, either was Malachi or was our ambassador at the time, or another Iraqi official that we had to escort. We had a 16-man team that we operated with. Most of them were ex-military, some were ex-SEALs, and the canine handlers went on every mission, either one or two. I came home the end of 2012. I've been home for about a year, and last week I got the phone call. They want me back in Iraq. So I'm going to be going back to the embassy as soon as my task orders are cut. And it's a privilege to be asked to speak today.
That's great.
Ladies and gentlemen, it now gives me a great pleasure and honor to introduce the person who started the Wisconsin War Dog, Ms. Carol Singer. Along with Carol is her friend and brother, Jerry Witt, a Vietnam canine handler with the Army's 34th Infantry Scout Dog Platoon. Carol and Jerry.
Good afternoon. Carol Singer and I met in 1999. I'm talking today because Carol gets a little nervous in front of all these people. Right, Carol?
Yes,
okay. So she asked me to do the honors, okay. She explained to me back then that she wanted to educate the public about the various breeds of dogs and how they served the military. She told me that the group participates in parades and by doing presentations to various organizations and schools. So I thought that I could help her with that mission because I had firsthand experience as a dog handler, and as soon as I said that, her eyes got as big as pies, of course, because we didn't have any dog handlers in her group. We had an idea about 5 years ago to raise enough money to erect a monument dedicated to those breeds of dogs. I am proud to say that our dream has finally come true. Carol, is there anything you'd like to say?
Just would like to thank everybody for coming and all the people in our group who've supported us, and to thank all the veterans for their service.
Ladies and gentlemen, I served in Vietnam with my dogs named Skip and Satan. Skip died of his wounds protecting me from a booby trap. Satan protected me from harm for the rest of my tour. At this time, I'd like to introduce three of very special friends of mine. These men served with me in Vietnam and are my brother dog handlers in the 34th Platoon. Gary Grant from Stand up, Gary. Minnesota. His dog name was Major. Joe Mays flew in from Denver, Colorado, and his dog's name was Bissy. And this next gentleman, who has suffered so much from Agent Orange. He has He has some diabetes. He's lost his leg. He's had some problems hearing, seeing. Joined us here today from Joliet, Illinois. His dog's name was Max, Mr. Bob France. Thank you. We mentioned our fellow brother that lost his life in October in Vietnam, Richard Monashinsky. And to this day, every time I do a presentation and every time we do talk somewhere, I'm going to steal your line, Joe. Everybody asks, well, when were you in Vietnam? And when we do those talks, we tell them last night. Because every time we do those talks, it takes us back to that time. And we feel that it's important for the young people today to realize and to understand what we did over there as dog handlers. We're here today to honor those four-legged vets. And they deserve that because they have served and they have saved untold thousands of lives, including my own. So we got this monument and we have it for as a forever memory to their to the testament of what they've done. And at this time, I would like to have Carol Singer unveil the monument with a little help from our friends, okay? Kevin, excuse me, I'm gonna do one more thing. I would be remiss if I didn't also acknowledge my good friend Kenny McCarthy. Stand, Kenny. Kenny was a door gunner in Vietnam and was shot down 13 times and lived to tell about it. Kenny, thank you, brother. I would like to thank Eugene Slasky, who at the age of 92 is a proud Marine. And I have the most respect for this man. He served in so many bloody battles in the South Pacific. Thank you, sir. And last but certainly not least, I would like to thank my son, Kevin, who served in the United States Navy. I'm so proud of you, son. Thank you. And now, Kevin, if you would help Carol, I would like to unveil the monument, please. You want me to hold Bella? Okay. You can just pull it off, Carol, no problem. And there it stands. Ladies and gentlemen, what I'd like to do, if I could, and then I'll get out of here, I would like to just read the poem that was written by Roger Robideau. It is inscribed in the stone, and it reads, "I am an American war dog. I obey orders from my brave handler. My job is to find, save, help, and comfort, and I try to do the best that I can. Being faithful is everything to me. Staying alert, I must always be. When my name is called out, proudly I stand to serve with love. I so try to do what is asked of me. If I die on duty, please remember. I am an American war dog, and my brave handler is my best friend. God gave me a life to love and give, and to be there when there is need. The time may come for my duty to end, and I will proudly be a K-9 Corps veteran. It will be hard for me to stop serving. I'll want to continue, but I know I cannot. Remember those like me who don't go to war. Many have duties that are so very important. I'm an American war dog, and I have the best friend in the world." Thank you.
Come on, brother. All right. One thing, if I start winking at you, it's not because I like you. It's because one of my lenses fell out. At this time, I'd like to present a certificate of recognition, Chief Brzezinski, from the Department of Veterans Affairs of the State of Wisconsin. This certificate is presented to the village of Menominee Falls. Since World War I, tens of thousands of dogs have served in the United States Armed Forces alongside their handlers and canine units. Thousands of military working dogs have died in combat while saving the lives of countless servicemen and women. The U.S. War Dogs Monument honors our nation's war dogs and their handlers, past, present, and future. Given on this date, June 22nd, under the signature of John Skolkas, Secretary of Wisconsin Department of Veterans Affairs. Thank you for allowing us to do this.
Absolutely.
It's Thank really
you.
Awesome.
Thank you.
Thank
for
you.
Having
and before we close this, I'm going to improvise a little bit because in the infantry, when I served 30 years in the infantry after I was in the Air Force, I tell everybody I went to the dark side by joining the Army. So I'm going to improvise a little bit because we improvise, adapt, and overcome in the infantry. I want all the wives of the Vietnam veterans and canine handlers to stand, please. And I'm going to point my wife out right there in the little hat. Because without her, I wouldn't be here today. She's been my rock. She's been my foundation. And that kind of support was what is what everybody needs, and thank you, Yolanda, I love you. All right, at this point in time, please rise for the benediction by Chaplain Stubbe and the playing of taps. Chaplain Stubbe.
Receive the blessing. May the strong arm of the Lord keep you safe and secure and bless you with peace and life. May the right hand of the Lord be your guide and strength in serving others. May you see God in the face of your friend. May the presence of the Lord be your vision as you live to give. May the peace of the Lord guard and keep you. May the Lord direct you into paths of nourishment, fullness of life, and strength in his holy name. Amen.
God bless you.
Okay, ladies and gentlemen, that concludes our ceremonies. Please stop by the tents for the war dogs. Okay, color guard, we cover. Okay.
Thank you all for coming.
And now, here's a brief photo essay by photojournalist Gwen Shepherd recapping today's event. And that's it for this edition of Veterans Newsline. Join us again next time for more veterans news and events from southeastern Wisconsin. Until next time, I'm Dave Ryba. Thanks for watching.